This story will cover from then to now and next, all about change, how to turn losers into winners. A feathery crown and what looks like makeup. Meet the Queen of the Marsh. Now in part two, we'll follow the story of this remarkable bird, its home and its human neighbours. Three people will feature alongside the cranes and show what individuals can achieve here in two places where crested or crowned cranes share the wetlands now under threat. But can losers be turned into winners? Yes, if Maurice Wanjala gets his way at Siwa in northern Kenya. Today he's been joined by another wetland enthusiast, Mary Mbengi, who's come to explore this special area and meet the community. That includes one of her favourites. This one is quite at home in the village. No threat here, but certainly elsewhere. The crown cranes will need all the help they can get from their friends.
Yeah, what we are doing at the moment is we are using...
And hopefully that will include the next generation, and now with mobile phones, iPads and television everywhere. Perhaps showing wildlife films like this one. That can help losers win. So can Maurice Wanjala.
My name's Maurice Wanjala. I'm the founder of Kipsaina Cranes and Wetland Conservation Group. This group was founded in 1990 with the main objective being saving Siwa and its wildlife. We realized that Siwa swamp had a little future unless concerted efforts were done. That's why we formed this group. Behind me is a success story. This is Kipsaina Wetland. This is a result of our group efforts. We have talked to the community, and I'm glad to mention here that the community around this area have been so positive that they have surrendered. They have actually withdrawn from this wetland. And as you can see, the indigenous vegetation has regenerated, and as a result, the sitatungas that had gone away during those dubious days have come back. We also have several nesting sites, crane nesting sites. We have about 70 different bird species.
Mary Mbengi scrutinizes this national park, which is minute compared with the famous Masai Mara and Tsavo. No elephants here, but to a biologist, a very special animal. Two of them here, actually. Sitatungas, living here on an island of water, vital to them and to the increasing human population all around. Hopefully these two will contribute to the small population hiding here. He's sending interest,
this morning,
and her less so.
Because they wouldn't be there the whole day, and maybe perhaps just seeing another another spectrum like that would be very rare. So it's really spectacular.
Nearly as spectacular is the star of the show, the crowned crane, with its characteristic call. Much smaller birds, wagtails, get up there, take aim and they're off to this very fertile feeding ground. But is it more fertile than a man-made field full of maize? An important question for this rare marsh and for the people. It's not an easy surface, and the water level changes with the rains, and those are changing with the climate. But the Sitatunga is well equipped. With splayed hooves, it can walk on watery weeds and swim well. But they can't fly. A crane certainly can.
Sitatunga is a special antelope. It's the only marsh antelope, the only antelope that lives in a swamp, really. And I love it because it's trying to survive even with months interference with ecosystem. Living in such a fragile ecosystem is not easy, and we need efforts to conserve the Sitatunga antelope. I like what Saiwa Swamp Park is doing, like erecting up a fence to prevent human-wildlife conflict.
Yes, birds can fly across boundaries, but that conflict can emerge when domestic animals like sheep and cattle come up against the wild ones like the shy Sitatunga. Here, as the symbol on the national park gate, it's separated by a fence, keeping cattle out. This is a typical case of people-wildlife conflict. More people, more pressure. But can it be turned round? Is it really possible for everyone to win? Sitatunga, crown cranes, and people. Well, we'll see. Caught in the middle is the crown crane, but how adaptable is it? It can fly to somewhere suitable, if that somewhere still exists. People need to know what's happening to their area, and this information centre will probably help, but it may involve some tricky decisions. The land stays the same size. Human populations do not. And that's pretty much true the world over, especially in East Africa. In Tanzania, for example, backed by Mount Kilimanjaro, pairs find plenty of space compared with neighbouring Kenya. Big wetlands, no people. Symbols of pair devotion, whether it's on a tear state or on the national flag of Uganda or the mountain lakes of the Mau in Kenya. So they can adjust to all sorts of landscapes, but the options are being reduced by human activity, a familiar story. But Maurice Wanjala could have an answer back there at Saiwa Swamp.
Behind me you can see there is a swamp. And in it, we have 17 nesting sites. This is a very good indication that even the water drawn from this particular swamp is safe for human consumption.
But what happens when the open fresh water disappears and is turned into a lake of sewage and covered in an alien weed called water hyacinth? A pair of crown cranes seem to cope and dance on. Mm-hmm. Well, what do you think of it so far? Not a lot. Strictly speaking, this was a boating and sailing club. It's not now, thanks to water hyacinth, a pest all over the world. Flourishing here on the opposite scene, runoff from a huge slum. The people could really benefit from clean water, of which the crown crane is such a potent symbol. From here it's a short flying time up the Rift Valley to Lake Naivasha. Water quality is an issue here too, and so is space. Glass instead of grass. Roses and carnations by the thousands for our supermarkets. Flown in every night. That's the real price of a rose, and that includes wild land. The sort that a crown crane pair might need to rear a family on. Chemicals enter the lake. A biological paradise. So far. Further up the food chain, fish eagles have been poisoned, possibly crown cranes too, because they eat all kinds of things. They're generalists. Seed heads, nuts, grains, insects, frogs, lizards and crabs. Biologists have reported on heavy use of agricultural pesticides, and researchers found that large numbers of crown cranes are killed annually by poisoning in Kenya, mainly as retaliation or to prevent crop damage. But down there, a crane's eye view reveals an island in a sea of glass, not grass. And if there was ever a friend of crown cranes, it was Joan Root. And she had lots of other friends. From the smallest of antelopes to the very biggest, sort of, named George the giraffe. A useful bit of prickly pruning, quite a mouthful for George. This old-fashioned house by the lake and its surrounding sanctuary for wildlife of all sorts was to prove fateful to dear Joan. Now, not many people have a zorilla, a kind of African skunk, the very opposite to an aardvark, A to Z, which she also had, named Million, after Aardvark. A million miles for one of your smiles. But her favourites were the crown cranes that lived around the house. Joan loved them all, and Lake Naivasha, where the wild cranes lived. Her undoing was there, not only threatened by diminishing wild space, but people hungry for space and its occupants of the lake, fish. Maybe her days were numbered. Beer? No. Lettuce? Yes. It's got lots of tilapia fish and other introduced species, an important and tempting challenge to a poor fisherman. Is that a possible mate or a competitor? Joan formed a group called the Task Force. Some had been previously convicted for illegal fishing, not having a license, so they knew about the business. Corruption was common. Tilapia are mouth breeders. They rear their babies in their mouths and make bowl-shaped nests on the bottom of the lake. And they can be very prolific if fished sustainably. Then in theory, everyone wins, not loses. But it does mean the rules must be obeyed for the benefit of future generations, not only of tilapia, but fishermen. Nets were confiscated and burned. Boats were taken away. And that's not going to get you many fishing friends. Diving birds died in big numbers. Less competition, though, for their human competitors, some said. Joan was a keen photographer. There was the evidence. Those were the facts. Some Africans agreed with her, others did not, and that was the problem. Joan's crowned crane was to become a symbol of her lake. As the pressure on it grew, so did the scientific interest in its condition and its future, one that Joan would never see. Help had come in the shape of a team from Earthwatch and the University of Leicester in England. Who painstakingly studied tiny creatures in the mud below to the big fish eagles in the sky above. The whole food chain, in fact, and carried out carefully over many years. Dr. David Harper is searching for a very small creature that has potentially a very big job to do. Amongst the water hyacinth, you remember the sailing club lake covered in green, is a weevil. But is it evil enough to destroy this aggressive plant? Brought into the rescue, it remains to be seen if it can win or will lose. Joan joins in, both in the field, right by her house, and at the lab. These long-term studies, in such detail, tell the team what is happening to the lake, flower farms, fishing, crown crane populations. All offer clues to these nature detectives, from the smallest bug to the tallest bird.
That's the sort of food that Alan Scullinwood would like.
Mm. Crayfish, another disastrous introduction. Food for some, but mainly a massive disruption to the nature of things here. Much has been changed. What about the cranes and their friend Joan Root?
Sticking back in.
Next to the birds that Joan loved, a memorial service was held at her house by the lake. The attendants showed the concern and respect. Friends from all over Kenya came following a tragic murder in her own home one fateful night. The crime remained a mystery. Those invited came from all walks of life, many of them from the world of wildlife. And the wildlife was there, of course, as if representing their lost one.
The biggest of which, I suppose, was about 8 foot long. So that was a great
a world expert on the ivory trade, another shameful killing of elephants.
Not far from where we're gathered now, Joan Root was murdered in cold blood.
A simple existence would be the property's main purpose while she lived.
Her previous husband, Alan, with whom she'd bought the house and shared their love of the lake and its inhabitants, though not all the human ones.
Regarding Naivasha's conservation, it is so much talk, 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 meetings, 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 but so little actually gets done.
A light-hearted contact again, the last waltz, perhaps.
What he did was he took us up and around the back of a magnificent canyon that was a bit reminiscent of Petra with sort of 600-foot cliffs.
The crane had a new mate.
The sun's not on the pool yet. And, you know, she said crocodiles like heat, they like warmth. And she said, let's just go and withdraw up under those rocks above.
And you all know what a huge, huge help she was to me in everything I did. She was really the producer of all the films that we made. The producer in the film world, the producer does all the dirty stuff, all the hard work that enables the director, that was me, to be creative and artistic. So she did all those jobs that I couldn't do or pretended I couldn't do. All our organizing, all our camps, all our travel, all the logistics, all the dreaded accounts. So she was really the producer, and everything we did back in those years together, she made possible.
I don't think there are many people here that know that in the 60s, Joan had an awful illness called myasthenia. It's a sort of autoimmune thing that attacks where the nerves that transmit the messages from, sorry, the chemicals that transmit the messages from your nerve endings to the muscles break down. And she could do it all. As bad as I've heard, obviously, she hardly reacted. A couple of years later, one of them nailed me. She was my right arm. She was the wind beneath my wings. And if we flew high and far in those days, it was because of her.
She was an exceedingly bright lady.
Life at prolific but much changed Lake Naivasha goes on. From the famous fish eagles to the wildebeest, stars of the great migrations, neighbours to crowned cranes now, and suddenly an invasion of the so-called umbrella bird, the black heron. Shading and attracting, perhaps, they've arrived en masse. Plus other fishermen, like flamingos, and egrets, and spoonbills, all using the tricks of their particular trades. The crowned crane is a generalist, and this was very much his kind of country on the flooded fields. This feeding frenzy would have thrilled Joan Root, an explosion of bird life, literally at the bottom of her garden. The grey crown crane has declined by 80% over the past 45 years. Many are traded, making it the fastest declining crane species in the world. So is it on the way out? At least not here it isn't. Morris Wanjala again, at Saiwa.
And it goes on turning life. The crested crane is a good wetland indicator, such that where the cranes exist, there is life. We have 17 nesting sites. This is a very good indication that even the water drawn from this particular swamp is safe for human consumption. As you can see, our group motto is touch one, touch all to 2030. This is meant to actually draw the attention of the entire community and even the entire public.
The Sitatunga antelope and the crown crane received attention, help and acclaim. Mary Mbengi joins in again, seeing how Morris's efforts with the local youth groups can really succeed here at Kipsaina and the Saiwa Swamp National Park. And it's all linked to trees, some even used to cure human ailments. It's a tree nursery. For this place, at least the future is bright. The future is green. Could it be that these birds and their lives could affect ours? To the extent that leaving more wild, wet places can enable these threatened losers elsewhere to become winners. They certainly should.